Right, welcome back to another episode of the GCN Tech Blitz, where I try and solve your bike-related problems. So if you've got something which is plaguing you and you can't go out on your bike, make sure you leave me that question down there in the comment section below, or alternatively, on all forms of social media using the hashtag AskGCNTech. And with no further ado, let's crack on with the first question this week. And it comes in from Yo Bro Beans. Right, now they say, I like the idea of the 10-tooth sprocket to increase the range of gears at both ends. However, I can't afford SRAM's Etap AXS groupsets as the wireless technology makes them too expensive for me. Would the crankset chain and cassette be compatible with any other components from different groups? So could they take the gearing from SRAM's mountain bike range and use it with a different groupset? If so, any suggestions, preferably mechanical gearing with hydraulic disc brakes? Well, right, you're not asking too much there, are you, Yo Bro Beans? Yeah, I guess you could actually make that work. I'm not sure that the mountain bike components could well work across with the road ones because they tend to have different pull ratios on the cables and everything because that's what you're going through there. And obviously you want to use mechanical gearing with hydraulic disc brakes. So importantly, you need to make sure that you've got a rear hub which is compatible with that cassette which has that 10-tooth sprocket on there. So you are gonna need an XDR driver compatible free hub. And I reckon probably the easiest thing for you to go with here is the Campagnolo hydraulic cable operated derailleurs, but obviously with hydraulic disc brakes. That's probably the thing which could well work, but I've not tried around with it, but certainly something for you to have to think about a little bit more because it's quite a complex situation you could well get yourself into. Next up is Avin Jansen. Now they say, please help, I love putting on bar tape and I've got it down to like a pro mechanic. I've just got a new bike with Di2 and the Di2 junction box and the controller, what you set it up with is at the end of the handlebar. How do I do my bar tape? Because it's got a cover that wraps around the end of the handlebar. Please help, a video would be great. Right, Avin, no video needed for this one, my friend. As you've said, that Di2 junction box that goes on the end of the handlebar does have a plastic cover which just slots over the outer circumference of the bar. What you're gonna need to do with your bar tape is essentially get it as far to the end as possible, almost butting up against that sort of plastic housing, and just wrap that tape as hard as you can without actually snapping or risk breaking or tearing the handlebar tape. I agree, it's probably not as good as the original style of how you're gonna fit bar tape, where you just have a little bit of overlap and whack it in with a bung there. But certainly this is what all the pro mechanics out there do. Next up is Colin Jones. Now Colin says, hi John, I do a lot of work on friends' bikes, which are all internally routed cabling. I've managed to get a few lengths of tubing from my local bike shop that are taken off of new bikes that they build from the box. This makes the job so much easier. So I would like to buy a decent length of it, but I have no way of knowing what size diameter to look for. Right, go for something with at least an internal diameter of 2 millimeters. That way you can use it for both gears as well as brakes, because of course an internal gear cable is a lot thinner. Well, I say a lot thinner, but it is, you know, a fraction of a millimeter thinner than a brake cable inner is. So go for something like 2 millimeters, because the thickest internal brake cable you're gonna get is probably about 1.6 millimeters. So 2 millimeter internal measurement is gonna give you enough room to chuck that cable in. And importantly, don't loan out this bit of internal tubing to anyone, because people have a habit of not returning things. And next up, we've got a question in from 1,000 subscribers with no videos challenge. That is such a weird username. Right, anyway, now they ask, hey John, I'm a junior racer and I need 7 meters or slightly below rollout for events. So if anyone doesn't know about this, when you're riding in youth categories and junior categories, you can't use, you know, a humongous gear during competition. The reason being is that generally your body and your bones haven't fully developed and you could risk some extra stress on it. So that's why exactly they have these rules in place. Anyway, back to that question. At the moment, I have a 14 to 28 cassette and 50 34 chainrings. I've calculated that I need a 52 tooth chainring to get the right rollout. However, I'm asking whether I can still keep my 34 tooth small ring. Can my Ultegra 6700 front derailleur handle an 18 tooth gap between my chainrings, or will I have to get a 36 tooth chainring as well? Thanks, Flynn. Right, a 34 tooth chainring, if you pair that up with a 52 outer ring, unfortunately your front derailleur is not gonna be able to handle that very effectively, meaning that probably, I don't know, three or four of your harder gears in your small ring. So if you're in the small chain ring and the smallest sprocket in the rear, the chain is going to drag over that front derailleur cage at its lowest pass. It's going to create so much noise. Really, the gear shifting is going to be absolutely terrible too. So the best thing you can do though is actually get a 36 tooth chain ring as well as a 52. Have a look around though, because you don't necessarily have to go for the exact ones, what you've got on there at the moment. You could look for an aftermarket alternative, which is going to serve you just as good. Next up is Mikey LP03. Right, there we are. Hi John, love the show. I'm restoring an old Trek 1000 and I would like to convert it from a 7-speed downtube shifter to a 1x10 speed downtube shifting. My question is twofold. So really, you've got two questions. Can I fit a 10-speed cassette? I've measured the rear dropout to 130mm. And secondly, is the downtube shifter capable of being indexed for 10 cogs? Thanks. Good news here, right, 130mm is what you need for 10 speed, so absolutely fine. Just make sure, of course, that the cassette is gonna fit on the free hub and everything. As for your gear lever being indexed for 10 speed, no, it's not gonna be, I'm afraid. You could put it into friction mode if that's possible on your shifters, but friction mode is really quite hit and miss, to be honest. It's just something more to faff around with down there. The good news is though, Shimano actually still do make a downtube 10-speed shifter. I think it's the SL7900. That's what I've got on my old Eddie Merckx that I sort of rejuvenated into a modern day equivalent of an old fashioned race bike, if that makes sense. So yeah, it is totally possible. Go ahead and do it and then submit it into the bike vault. Right, next up is Al Val, who says, hello from Barcelona. Right, congratulations on the channel. I ride an aluminium Cannondale Cadex. I'm going to replace my aluminium fork with a carbon one. I'd appreciate any advice about the correct installation of the compression plug, carbon paste needed. Talk of the bolt, how to avoid galvanic corrosion between the frame and the fork. Right, okay, so you could apply carbon paste around the internal of the steerer tube before you put the expander bolt in place. I've never done it. I don't think I know anyone who actually does that, but I guess it couldn't do any harm. As for the torque of the expander plug bolt, well, it does depend on what you're using. So some of the really lightweight ones, they don't recommend torquing them up too much, whereas some of the beefier ones actually recommend up to 8 Newton meters, believe it or not. Now, you mentioned about avoiding galvanic corrosion. Well, really, you need to keep on top of your maintenance. So make sure the bike's clean and you're using grease and lubricant where necessary. Really, if you're going to start sweating all over it, you are going to get a little bit of corrosion. So yeah, just make sure you wash the bike as and when it's necessary. Next up is Michael Field. Now, Michael says, John, when climbing and swinging the bike side to side, I can hear the front disc rubbing when it's at full tilt. Is this normal or can I stop it happening? I've centered the caliper. Thanks. Right, it's not totally normal, but it is normal to have a little bit of flex in between a frame and a wheel or a fork and a wheel in your case. Something here to consider really is that with disc brakes, the tolerances are way closer than with rim brakes. And rim brakes, we tend to have a few millimeters either side of the rim where the brake pads are, whereas on disc brakes, it's a lot closer. So any discrepancies are much easier noticed. I mean, we hear it on rim brakes, for instance, too. Normally, a lot more when the weather's actually wet rather than in the dry. Something here to consider is that maybe your disc brakes need bleeding to try and get the pistons to retract fully, or alternatively, they just need cleaning a little bit to try and help them move in and outwards. Just give it a blast with some disc brake cleaner. But yeah, it's not that normal, but it is something that can be picked up with someone with very good hearing like you. And the final one this week comes in from Glenn Fullwood, who says, hi John, I look forward to the GCN Tech Clinic each week. That's good to hear, Glenn. I have a compact chain set, 5034, that came with my Bianchi. I live in southwestern Australia, where it's almost as flat as a pancake. I very rarely use the 34 tooth chainring, but when I do, it's always in smally smalls, 5012, 5013. I reckon they mean 3412 or 3413, but it's acceptable. As I feel that the 34 tooth chainring is wasted, can I change it for a 42 or 44? Will an inner chainring as big as 44 not work with the 50? Or is this not a wise idea? Look forward to hearing back, Glenn. Glenn, lovely part of the world out there in Australia. I look forward to my annual visit each and every year. Right, okay, it's absolutely fine to put a 42 or 44 inner ring on there, and if anything, you're gonna get even snappier shifting from your front derailleur. Something to consider though, 44 tooth chainrings aren't generally that common, so it could be a little bit more difficult to find, but 42 is going to be a piece of cake for you. So go ahead, fit that. No more smally smalls out there for you at all. Right, I hope I've been able to help answer or solve your problem this week. If not, leave it for me down there in the comment section below using the hashtag AskGCNTech, and I'll do my very best to answer it in an upcoming episode. As ever, remember to like and share this video with your friends too, and don't forget to check out the GCN shop at shop.globalcyclingnetwork.com. And now for two more great videos, how about clicking just down here and just down here.